That's fine, okay. Yeah.
All right.
Live, so.
Should we take our masks off, or does it?
For the talk, I think it's better for like lip reading, but if you really do want to keep it on, then that's fine.
No, it's all right. I'm not worried about you either.
Okay.
No, because
okay.
I just had COVID. So.
I feel good.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's go take a seat. I'll take it on.
Yeah, that's what.
Sorry, I'll be at the first.
Hello, one and all. Thank you for coming to St. James Cathedral this afternoon. Thank you for your patience as we delayed the opening of the doors. Few substitute players in this concert, but it still promises to be a very wonderful event. And my name is Robbie Ellis. I am here for this pre-concert talk, and I've got two of the six performers with me on stage. And to my immediate right, Susan Warner. She is a clarinet player in the Lyric Opera Orchestra. We have players from the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, the Lyric Opera Orchestra, and the Milwaukee Symphony Orchestra on stage this afternoon. Susan plays in the Lyric Opera Orchestra, also the Prairie Winds. I'd love to talk about that group in a little bit. And then the furthest on your left is Emma Gerstein, principal second flute of the Chicago Symphony. Is it something like that?
Yes.
Something like that. A flute player in the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, Chicago native, got a job in her hometown, but used to work in my hometown, which I'd like to talk about briefly as well. So two pieces on the program today, Louise Farrenc and Maurice Ravel. And we'll talk about the pieces in a bit. But first, the last time we talked, Susan, was for a Rush Hour concert, but part of the series, but not here. It was the 2020 Rush Hour concert series.
Right. So you all might remember there was a little something that happened in 2020.
I got no idea what.
Anyway, we were lucky as a family to perform on the Rush Hour series. So it involved me, my husband Dave Griffin, who plays horn in the Chicago Symphony, our son Henry Griffin, who is a baritone singer and a pianist, his girlfriend Tian Chin, who lived with us for 15 months, God bless her, and our daughter Pearl Griffin, who played the harp.
These family affairs, they're wonderful things, and they were, it's like seeing that you have, you don't have a fridge full of ingredients, you don't have the full city's worth of players, you have these five ingredients in the fridge, what can we make of it for a concert?
Oh my goodness, if I have to play another horn and clarinet duet.
I'm sick of playing with my husband. Yeah, I guess there probably aren't that many. Yeah,
no.
Got to rearrange bits and pieces.
Yeah.
And I'll talk to Emma now as well. Emma, I'm excited to have you in this because you had the principal job of my hometown orchestra for a little bit.
I know. I'm excited to talk to you too because, of course, I listen to WFMT. And my parents came to visit me in Auckland. And when they came back and they heard you on the radio, they were excited that there was a Kiwi accent that they could listen to all the time. And I've been enjoying listening to you on the radio too.
When were you playing with the Auckland Philharmonia Orchestra?
I went there in 2016 and I stayed for about 18 months. And then I started my job here in the fall of 2017.
Got it. I was living here at the time,
yep.
/ on cruise ships. But so there's a slight possibility that I was in the broadcast booth when you did three-cornered hat with Giordano Bellincampi.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Could have
been. We were in the same room at the same time.
Yay!
In Auckland. Yes. but yeah, you've managed to get a job in your hometown orchestra.
Yes.
You grew up here in the city and... What did that mean to get that job?
It was a really memorable day. You know, of course, getting any job in any orchestra is very difficult, much less a job in an orchestra like the Chicago Symphony, but it added that I was coming home. Of course, I was also really sad to be leaving New Zealand because it was really beautiful and I didn't get to spend enough time there. But my husband's Australian, so I do get to go back to that part of the world.
Well, there we are. You can always travel when you got the time to do that. Susan, I'll come back to you because you are a member of a permanent woodwind quintet. Now, we're not hearing a strict quintet today. We're hearing a quintet plus one. But what is it like playing in a woodwind quintet, and what are the possibilities, and how is it different from, say, a string quartet?
Right, right. Well, In a wind quintet, we always strive for finding a way to make our sounds blend and sound beautiful together. Whereas I think in a string quartet, they kind of have that built in already, having the similar way that they make the sound. So that's the challenge of a wind quintet. At the same time, I think playing in a wind quintet really enhances orchestral playing, really makes your ear tuned to the rest of the wind and the horn players. So,
yeah. And I love the ensemble of a woodwind quintet as a composer too, and I've never written one, and I really, because there are so many colors to explore and so many doublings that you can ask the players to do, like flute for piccolo and oboe for cor anglais, and then they say, oh, do I really have to get this out?
Right.
But yeah, so many colors available. And what's it like adding a piano to the mix? Because as a woodwind quintet, none of you are fixed pitch instruments, right? You can always adjust your intonation slightly and make something a little sharper, a little flatter, depending on the context. But does it help or hinder to play along with a piano?
I feel like it kind of roots us a little bit and gives us a place to really aim for harmonically, but also it gives kind of an orchestral feeling to this wind quintet, which sometimes can sound a little on the bright side. So. Yeah.
Well, I'll move on to the music now, and Emma, have you? Oh, don't worry, I'm not going to do too many quizzes here.
I hope not.
This is, but the first piece on the program is the Sextet for Winds and Piano by Louise Farrenc. Now, her name turned up in this concert series, I think 2 weeks ago. There was a trio for clarinet, cello, and piano. She was the first and only professor at the Paris Conservatoire for all of the 19th century. On the entire teaching staff of the Conservatoire across 100 years, she was the only woman to work there. And for 10 years, she was paid less than her male colleagues until she fought and won for equal pay after a particular success of a nonet. At the premiere included Joseph Joachim, who was Johannes Brahms' favorite violinist. Very much renowned as a piano teacher, composer of piano music, but in the 1840s, 1850s, she turned her hand to chamber music more, and one of the pieces that she wrote was this sextet. And have you played the music of Louise Farrenc before?
I have not. I have to admit, I had not heard of her until a few days ago when I found out I was playing this concert.
You are one of the three COVID substitutions in this concert.
Yes.
Be careful out there, everyone. Does Louise Farrenc's music remind you of any other composers as you've been playing it?
That's a good question. I don't know. It's kind of it's light and kind of classical, almost. Sue.
I don't know. Maybe like early, almost early American. Like it has a little bit of touch of romanticism to it.
Yeah. So maybe some. A little bit of Schumann feel, a little bit of, it's light, but it's also this big C minor texture with like these huge great piano runs, and she was a pianist herself, so it's a lot of virtuosity in there. So that's the first piece on the program, her sextet in C minor. She's possibly the very first composer ever to write for that exact combination, which is wind quintet. So wind quintets have long existed, but wind quintet plus piano, she was probably the very first. And then after that, two pieces on the program, Maurice Ravel was born the same year that Louise Farrenc died. We are celebrating French wind music today. And his suite, Mother Goose, was originally for two pianos, but he orchestrated it too. It is beloved. I'm sure that both of you have played it multiple times. I've played it in an orchestra. As you were rehearsing the very first movement, there's a moment which is, obviously you don't have a double bass, but I was thinking, boom, boom, boom. It's like, yes, I remember that, but I would be able to play along with that much, and that's about it. But yeah, this arrangement, it's obviously not full orchestral, but it feels like it'd be an easy enough job for the arranger to take the orchestration and reduce it to this, because so much of the orchestral version is lovely flute solo, lovely clarinet, horn line, etc.
Okay, but we are missing one thing. And if any of you have a gong in your back pocket, we do have a solo for you.
So this is the princess of the pagodas. The section. Very much of a Chinese influence there. But are there any revelations to the work playing it with reduced forces like this? Is it it's like a clearer texture? I mean, how do you improve on Ravel's orchestration? You kind of don't.
Boy, I don't necessarily think the arranger improved on it. He actually was honored it very well, you know, and in fact used most of the voicings of the original. I think it transferred beautifully and not improved, just honored.
And we'll be seeing some quick changeovers from Emma. Flute and piccolo. This is sort of common in woodwind quintets and ensembles like this, that you'll often have to change instruments quickly.
Yes, actually, the second flute part for Mother Goose Suite is often asked for on flute auditions because there's flute. It starts with a huge flute solo in the second flute part, and then there's also a lot of piccolo. So you have to change back and forth, and that's a skill they want to hear at an audition.
It's a skill that flute players have to have, that your lap can't be sloping down like this.
Yes, that's a bit scary. I had to consider that with my shoes tonight. I didn't want to, you know, have a heel that was too high so that I'd be sloping.
Well, thank you so much for joining me for this talk. Before we finish up, there are just a couple more events that I'd like to mention, put on by the International Music Foundation. Tomorrow's Dame Myra Hess Memorial Concert, a mile down the street that way, features Michael Tran on clarinet and Lilia Wolschlager on piano. They're playing music by Debussy, Montgomery, and Brahms. The Jesse Montgomery piece is called Peace. Two different spellings of peace there, though. And then the next Rush Hour concert, 1 week from today right here, the Lincoln Trio, always love seeing them. They've just released an album of piano trios from Chicago. You're going to hear some of those pieces by Sean O'Pebolo, Shalomit Ran, and Stacey Garrop. And there's also a little extra piece from Juan Cuellar in there. I'm very much looking forward to talking to them, COVID willing. In the meantime, please thank Susan Warner and Emma Gerstein, and you'll see them in 15 minutes. Hello and welcome to this Rush Hour concert, French wind music here in St. James. There are the chimes here in St. James Cathedral in Chicago. I'm Robbie Ellis. This concert is presented by the International Music Foundation with support from the Claire, Rush Hour Concert's exclusive media sponsor, as well as the National Endowment for the Arts and the Illinois Arts Council. There has been a change to the performer lineup. Your printed programs are slightly inaccurate. Horn player David Griffin has been replaced by his CSO colleague, David Cooper. And now to play Louise Farrenc's Sextet and Maurice Ravel's Mother Goose Suite, please welcome today's performers, flutist Emma Gerstein, oboist William Welter, Susan Warner on clarinet, David Cooper on horn, bassoonist Catherine Chen, and pianist Mio Nakamura. Thank you.